I am so thankful for brother and sister in the Lord, Joseph and Jessica, and been wanting them to come for a while, and God just orchestrated it for it to happen. So let's open up our hearts to hear from God, and also let's be ready. God may want to do, you know, I believe God wants to do a work of healing in people's hearts today. It can be physical, emotional, mental, anyway. God can do it. Amen? So let's welcome Brother Joseph here today.
Amen. If you love the Lord, give him a great big hand. Amen. If you love your pastors, give them a great big hand. I tell you, they're the two sharpest pastors in all of northern New England, and we are blessed to be here. My wife and I are excited for what God is going to do. We have sensed the power and the glory of the Lord in this place so mightily and so readily already. Just going to change this around here. Feel like home. Rearrange the furniture. Two things about me that I should warn you about. I have a very extremely dry sense of humor. So if you wonder, should I be angry, should I be confused, or should I laugh, just go ahead and laugh. We were preaching at a church several years ago, and I made a really, really, really dry joke. And people, they just sat there. And I said, that's okay. That's why I've got this water here with me. And then they laughed, and everything was okay after that. This is the second thing that I want to share and have some grace with this. Your pastor or anybody didn't tell me anything about anybody. So if I happen to say something or preach about something, and I just want you to know the pastor's not told me anything about anybody or anything that's been going on. But how many know that just like we sang, the Lord sees us, the Lord knows, the Lord understands, and despite seeing us and knowing us and understanding us, he loves us. And so if he says something that gets us riled up a little bit, then we need to understand that he is saying that in love to us for what? To set us free. Amen? Amen. There's liberty in the house today. So glad to have our church with us. A few that are here. Thank you for coming, making the trek all the way in an hour or so. And then also my wife does a Bible study on Thursdays, and people from that Bible study came. So we're so glad to have every single one of you with us today. Our heart's cry in all of our experience with Jesus has been, Lord, we want more. More of you. More of what you have for us. We believe that these are the finest hours of the church. We believe in Pentecostal power. We don't believe in sideshow tricks or psychological manipulation, but we believe in a divine visitation, not just of the power of God and the glory of God, but the person of Jesus Christ. And he's here today. He's here today. When we are gathered in his name, he is in our midst. And when we worship him in spirit and in truth, he's here. We've done that today. We've done that today. But our cry is more, more, more. No matter what you've experienced, no matter where you are in your relationship with Jesus, there is always more for you to experience in the Lord. There is always more about Jesus that He wants to reveal to you than you've ever encountered or understood before. If all you have of the Lord is all that there is, your God is too small. Because it'll take all of eternity for us to understand and experience all that He is. Are you ready to go? Are you ready to go? Not just are you ready to go to heaven, but are you ready to encounter more of God? Because He wants to shake you up and wake you up and cause an outpouring of His Spirit to come on your life, not just to quench your thirsty soul, but to bring rivers in the desert to this lost and dying dry world that needs the outpouring of living waters in their soul. Are you ready not just for yourself, but are you ready for them? Are you ready for the lost? How will they hear unless someone comes and speaks to them? The love of Jesus. But Lord, You've given us the missionary. You've given us the evangelist. Let the pastor do that. It's every single one of our responsibility and call as a disciple of Christ to share Him everywhere that we go and all that we do. Because not just because of some hanging over my head sense of obligation, well, I'm a believer, I'm a Christian, I've got to share Jesus, but because you have encountered His love and His presence and His power has changed your life, and your very essence cries out of His love and His mercy and His grace. God has always had a people of His presence. We are the people of His presence. At the end of last year, the Lord spoke to us that going into this new year to set aside a special season to seek His face in a greater measure, in a greater way, and we did that. And as we came out of that season, my wife and I, we began to pray, Lord, do unusual things in our lives, but not just in our lives, but through our lives. Because, hey, like Pastor said, this isn't all just about me. It's what the Lord wants to do in you, He wants to do through you. He can only bring change and transformation in life to the world around you as you are changed and transformed and experience the life of Jesus in your life. You can't give what you don't have. We said, Lord, do unusual things. I appreciate that song that you sang, Wide-Eyed and Mystified. We need to come back to that in the body of Christ. To be like a child. Jesus said you can't enter into the kingdom of heaven unless you become like a child. And what's the beauty of a child? But everything that happens in this great big world is awesome. Wonderful. We said, Lord, we want to be in awe and in love with what You do. Again. One of the things in that time of seeking the face of the Lord is we were believing for the Lord to extend our tent peg in the sense of ministry-wise. We had been an assistant pastor for 3.5 years, and then the Lord transitioned us out of that ministry into an evangelistic ministry where we went, we saw miracles, and the Lord did great things, and people were saved and delivered, and God just showed up big time. And then that season, like the Brook of Cherith, seemed to dry up, and God moved us into pastoring a church where we've been for seven years now. And the Lord began stirring in our hearts that He was going to begin to open doors for outside ministry. And that was one of the areas that we had sought the Lord about. Lord, bring a breakthrough in our church and then a breakthrough in our ministry. Open doors for us. So at the beginning of this month, in answer to prayer, your pastor, we're gathering together with a group of great ministers, however not quite as sharp as your pastor and his wife, but it wasn't long after I came through the door, your pastor approached me and he said, I have an unusual request. And how many know that once you've prayed certain things before the Lord and then those words come back to you, that's him saying, hello. So he said, I have an unusual request, and I said, yes. He said, want to invite you to come and speak? And I said, well, that's an answer to prayer. And I told our church the other week, I said, now don't worry, we've been praying and asking the Lord, seeking His face, that He would begin to open doors of ministry for us. And I said, there are other days of ministry other than just Sunday morning, you know, for churches to have us come. But we're honored to be here and to join services with you. And so we said we're gonna close down our service Sunday morning and we're gonna come together as the body of Christ. How will the world know that you are my disciples but by your love one for another? And if we're too stuck in the mud and said, this is me and my crowd, and, you know, people are going to have to understand that, well, we'll miss the boat. We'll miss what God wants us to do. And as I began to seek the face of the Lord again about what to bring as a message and to share, the Lord drew my attention to Exodus chapter 33. This is a story of Moses and God and their conversation together on the mountain. And we pick up in verse 7. This intimate conversation. Actually, a few verses later, but we'll see this here. Exodus 33, verse 7 says, now Moses used to take the tent and pitch it outside the camp a good distance from the camp, and he called it the tent of meeting. And everyone who sought the Lord would go out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp. And it came about whenever Moses went out to the tent that all the people would arise and stand each at the entrance of his tent and gaze after Moses until he entered the tent. Whenever Moses entered the tent, the pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses. When all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance of the tent, all the people would arise and worship, each at the entrance of his tent. Thus the Lord used to speak to Moses face to face, just as a man speaks to his friend. When Moses returned to the camp, his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, would not depart from the tent. Then Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up this people, but you yourself have not let me know whom you will send with me. Moreover, you've said, I have known you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now therefore, I pray you, if I have found favor in your sight, let me know your ways that I may know you, so that I might find favor in your sight. Consider, too, that this nation is your people. And he said, the Lord said, my presence shall go with you, and I will give you rest. Then he said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not lead us up from here. For how then can it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not by your going with us, so that we, I and your people, may be distinguished from all the other people who are upon the face of the earth? See, this is what distinguishes the people of God from the rest of the peoples of the earth. It's the power and the presence of God that is with us. Then the Lord said to Moses, I will also do this thing of which you have spoken. For you found favor in my sight, and I have known you by name. Then Moses said, I pray you, show me your glory. And he said, I myself will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim the name of the Lord before you, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show compassion on whom I will show compassion. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no man can see me and live. Then the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and you shall stand there on the rock. And it will come about, while my glory is passing by, that I will put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I will take my hand away, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we stand in your presence. Surely you dwell in the praises of your people. And you are dwelling here today. I pray, Father, that just as Jacob laid his head to rest on the stone at Bethel, that then you gave him the dream of a ladder coming down from heaven, and he saw the ascending and the descending of angels. May we have a landing pad of God's holy presence here today, Lord, that your power may ascend and descend upon us, that we would be a people that is marked, a people that know your presence, that have seen your face, whose name you have burned within our soul. That we not go from this place not having been touched, challenged, and transformed, healed, saved, and delivered, and set free in every area of our lives. Glorify your name, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for the gifts of your Spirit. Lord, we thank you for an open heaven today. We loose the word of knowledge. We loose that spirit of wisdom and revelation in Jesus' name. We loose that spirit of faith in the name of Jesus. We loose the gift of faith in the house today to come upon your people to receive from your hand what you have for them and what they have need of from you, God. We loose the spirit of revival and awakening in this house today in Jesus' name. Shake this place, God. Change us. Transform us. Let us be vessels of honor for your glory. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Two key verses I want you to understand today, and I pray that they be burned in your spirit like never before. May the branding iron of the Holy Ghost take and press these verses so deep within your heart that it becomes your heart's cry as it has become mine. Verse 15, Moses says to God, if your presence does not go with us. And verse 17, I pray, show me your glory. There's a little background to this story and this encounter of Moses with the presence of God. In the previous verses, we find that Moses had ascended to the mountain and had received an encounter with God like no man has ever had before and no man has ever had since. Where the very glory of God descended upon that mountain, even so much where the children of Israel were told, do not touch the mountain, because if you touch the mountain, you will die. Moses was up there in the presence, in the very raw and real glory of God for 40 days and 40 nights, not having eaten a thing and not drinking a thing, but basking in and feasting at the king's table. So he was sustained. And let me tell you, there's a lot of junk in this world that you can feed yourself with and stuff yourself with, but you'll just have to keep coming back to the world's table for one more drink and one more hit and one more one-night stand to try to get some kind of satisfaction and try to itch some itch that you can't seem to reach by yourself. So you grab for that drink, or you grab for that joint, or you grab for that person's hand. But let me tell you, when you come into the very presence of God and you get real with Jesus Christ, He will satisfy you, satisfy that itch in your soul that you can't reach without somebody else. Because let me tell you, nobody can go to the depth of your heart, to the depth of your soul, like the hand of God can reach down and scratch your itch like never before. Hallelujah. He was in the glory of God, and He was satisfied, not just spiritually, but physically. And God wrote with His finger on tablets of stone and gave the Ten Commandments and the law to Moses to take down to the children of Israel. And He began to descend from the mountain, and He heard a strange noise and saw a strange sight. Here are the children of Israel, who God has led out of bondage and slavery and captivity, and here they are dancing around a golden calf. And what is even more shocking than that, the guy that is Moses' right-hand man, the high priest, Aaron, is dancing around that baby too. And the righteous indignation of God burned within Moses' heart, and Moses took and shattered those commandments to the ground. And make a long story short, he took the calf and broke that down and ground it into powder and scattered the remains of that thing. And it says, and I was always shocked by this, and I said, well, this is an unusual thing. This is a strange thing. You know what else happened? They took some of that which was destroyed from the golden calf, and it ground so finely, made the people consume. What an experience. We say, Lord, we want an experience with Your presence. Let me tell you, you better do it God's way, or you'll be in trouble. You'll have golden calf for lunch. You're good. You're good. You're good. See, Moses had delayed too long in coming down from the mountain. And the children of Israel got a little antsy, and they got a little itchy, and they said, you know, Moses is never coming down. We don't even know. He might be dead up there for all we know. But we've got to serve God. He brought us out. So let's get our gold watches and our gold earrings and our gold Rolls Royces and throw them into the fire, and poof, this golden calf has jumped out. And so they began to dance and worship around that golden calf. And let me tell you, they had known the power and the presence of God. They had seen the glory of the Lord descend in Egypt with those plagues that had been a sign and a wonder. They had seen the water come gushing out. They had seen all of these displays of God's miracles, but yet, because it seemed to take too long, they got a little too antsy, a little too quick. They decided to take matters into their own hands. We get in trouble in the church when we try to take matters into our own hands. God has given us a pastor that understands God, knows God, whom he has chosen and called and placed above the body of Christ to lead them into the promised land. But yet sometimes we don't think, God, you're not doing it fast enough. God, you're not doing it quick enough. God, you're not doing it like I think you need to do it. And so we take matters into our own hands and we begin to try to orchestrate things outside of that authority that the pastor has been given by God. We try to come to the pastor and say, well, we need to do it this way, and God has given me a revelation on this, and God has said this to me, that we need to do it this way. But how many know that God has given gifts to his church? And before we even get to words of knowledge and miracles and prophecy, there are apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers. How can we experience the power of God in our midst if we're not willing to listen and give heed and obey the gift that God has placed to us right in front of us? We say that we love God, but yet we don't love the brother that we have seen and the sister that we have seen. Moses delayed too long in coming to them with the things of God, so they created a substitution, false system of worship. How long the church in New England has yearned for another great revival. How long the church in New England has longed for another great awakening. We've waited so long in New England, I dare say that some of us have grown cold and complacent. They created, and we have created, a false system of worship that God has not instituted. There are many golden calves that we dance around. We become satisfied with less than God's intention for the church. Let me say this, that the church is more than just a system or a structure. Although everything has a proper place, the church is not a system or a structure, not so rigid and not so bound, but the church is a living system. It's an organic being made of living stones, Peter says. This living system is empowered and energized by the very presence and the power and the glory of God. And we cannot be satisfied with anything less than the power and the presence and the glory of God in our midst. This has been my cry, and I know that this is your cry. Just like this, the cry of Moses. If your presence does not go with us. Now, I'm not claiming this for myself, but I use it as a figure of expression. I am sick and tired of having church for church's sake. I'm sick and tired of coming through doors, walking past pews, and standing behind a wooden pulpit and preaching a word that seems to go flat to the ground, because I've been trained, because I know my role. I'm sick and tired of having church for church's sake. You can ball this whole junk up and throw it in the garbage. As Pentecostals, we get a little uppity, we get a little proud, because, oh, we heard back in Azusa Street, the Holy Spirit was poured out, and our church comes from that outpouring. So we're a little bit better than the Lutherans. We're a little bit better than the Baptists. We're a little bit better than the Methodists. We're a little bit better than the Episcopalians, because we've got the presence of God that was poured out over 110 years ago. Let me tell you something. If you're holding on to something that was done 110 years ago, no matter how much heaven touched earth, you are living in a dead, false system of religion. If the presence of God is not in it, get out of it. We need to have a fresh touch of God's Spirit in our heart and in our life, and we need it in the sanctuary of God for the glory of God. There is nothing that will shake New England. There is nothing that will awaken this world except for the experience of the glory of God in our midst. If the world was won by education, it would have been won 100 years ago. And don't misunderstand me. I'm all for education. I have an earned master's degree. I'm all for academics. I'm all for putting your mind to good use, because as I said once and I'll say again, a Pentecostal mind is a horrible thing to waste. Amen. Who better? Whose mind better to anoint than those that have received the power and the presence of God? So the power, the presence, the glory of God does not mean you check your brains at the door. But how many know that God wants to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or imagine? So that means even beyond all of our mental processing, God is still able to blow our minds. Wide-eyed and mystified. Lord, let us never lose our wonder of you. Let us never shortchange your glory. Let us never shortchange your power. Because we think we've got it all figured out. That this is the way that God has to move, and he must move this way, and he can't move that way, and he shouldn't move this way. Let me tell you, if you begin to think that way and allow your mentality to dominate you in that way, you've created a false system of worship. We need to set aside our own expectations and allow God to move like he wants to move. But this world, if it would have been won by education, it would have been won hundreds of years ago. If it would have been won by a religious system, it would have been won 1,000 years ago. But nothing will heal a hungry heart and a hurting soul like the very power and the presence of God in our midst. We need a fresh outpouring of the glory of God in the church of God today. And the assemblies of God too. I want you to notice two things here. No mercy. Not your watches. Two things that are linked to his glory. All of his goodness, it says, where is that? Verse 19, I myself will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. Two things linked with the glory of God: his goodness and his name. His goodness and his name. His goodness. Everything good that he is. Not everything good that he that just that he has, but everything that he is. How many times you give a gift to a child that is so precious and dear to your heart? You give a gift to that child, and the greatest thing that they can experience is not that gift, but the heart of the giver. He gives gifts because of our relationship with him. He gives his goodness to us in ways that we can tangibly experience and hold on to. And then he reveals his name. This is what is beautiful about the name. A name is more than just something I call myself. Me, a name I call myself. A name. What is in a name? A name is linked to the very essence of a person. God's name is linked to his very being. One thing that we try to keep closely guarded in our modern society is our identity. And we only really reveal our true identity and who we really are to those with whom we are most intimate. God wanted to intimately reveal who he was to his people, and this would be done through his name. God said, I will answer your cry. My presence shall be with you. You shall see my glory. He says that you can't see my face, but my glory will pass by you, and it'll be such an experience. Your physical self won't be able to maintain its molecular structure if you experience everything that I have for you to experience. And I need to hide you in the cleft of the rock, and I'll put my hand on you and pass by you, and then when I take my hand away, you'll see my backside. You'll see me on the way out. You'll catch just a glimpse of me. How many know that sometimes all that we need is just a glimpse of who he is to change our situation? Just a glimpse of who he is to set our hearts free. Moses received an experience where the glory of God passed by. But more than Moses' desire for the glory of God to just pass by, we find in Scripture that God desired to dwell amongst his people. God was not satisfied with just a passing by experience. We find God fulfilling that desire in John chapter 1, in verse 9. The Apostle John records, there was the true light which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. It says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That word there, dwelt among us, means literally to tabernacle. God was not satisfied with just a passing by experience, but he wanted to mingle. God came to earth and pitched his tent on earth in the person of Jesus Christ. God revealed all that he was, is, and will forevermore be in our Lord. You cannot separate Jesus from God. You cannot separate God's presence, glory, and name from the person of Jesus. There is no other revelation ever, ever, ever of who God is except Jesus Christ the Son. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 says, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name given under heaven whereby men must be saved. Not might be saved, not should be saved, but must be saved. There is only one way to God, and his name is Jesus Christ. For he himself has said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. There is no other name. Krishna is not the name. Muhammad's not the name. Allah is not the name. Confucius is not the name. Your favorite political person or party is not the name, is not the savior of the country. There is only one king. There is only one Lord. There is only one way to heaven, and His name is Jesus. And let me encourage you today, if you're sitting here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, in just a little bit, we're going to give you an opportunity to receive heaven on earth every single day of your life. And how many know that heaven is not just a place that we go after we die if we know Jesus, but heaven is a place that we live in now, because Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is near you, yea, it's even in you. Heaven is not a place you go after you die. It's an environment and a spirit that you live in when you receive Jesus. Jesus revealed that those who would believe would see the glory of God. The glory of God is the nature, is the natural habitation of God's people. A part of God's glory is His power to overcome, destroy, and annihilate the effects of sin and the power of Satan. The Apostle John in 1 John 3:8 said, "The Son of Man has been manifested to destroy the works of the devil." What are the works of the devil? Well, we know that the book of Acts says that how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth and anointed Him with the Holy Spirit. He preached the good news, and He healed the sick and set free all who were oppressed of the enemy. Sickness is a work of the devil. Sin and the bondage to sin is a work of the devil. The wars and the frustration and the bloodshed in this world is a work of the evil one. But the power and the presence and the glory of Jesus has come that the power of Satan might be undone. And not just undone, but to be put away with, to be put under the feet of every person that will put their hand in the hand of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In John 11, we see that one of Jesus' best friends, his name was Lazarus. Jesus, one day sitting there on the rock with his disciples, got a Facebook message from Mary. Said, "Come quick, the guy, your BFF, your best friend Lazarus, he's sick. And it doesn't look like he's going to get any better. He's on the way out. Come. Work a miracle." Jesus said, "Nah, I think I'll wait." Finally, Jesus shows up. And after waiting too long, Jesus arrives to Lazarus' house to only be greeted with the news that Lazarus had died. Jesus tries to calm the bereaved family by saying, "Didn't I tell you that you would see the glory of God if you believed?" But Jesus says, "Take me to the tomb, roll back the stone." And one of the sisters says, "Lord, we roll back that stone, you're going to get knocked out by the stench, because it's already been 4 days and his body is rotting in this heat and humidity." Jesus said, "I don't care what it looks like and I don't care what it smells like. Open the door." Steps to the entrance of the tomb, and good thing he used Lazarus' name, because I truly believe that if he didn't use Lazarus' name, that whole tomb would have been empty. But he went to the mouth of the cave, and he said of the tomb, and he said, "Lazarus, come forth." Lazarus came forth. Maybe you're stuck in a situation here this morning where you feel like you've cried out to God for so long, and it seemed like he hasn't heard your prayer. Jesus, you've waited too long. The situation has gone from bad to worse. There's nothing now that can be done. Maybe you're here today. Maybe you've cried out to Jesus. It seems like he hasn't heard your prayer. hasn't heard your cry. Maybe you feel like this situation has been in my life for so long. I've had this sickness. I've been under this bondage of this disease for so long that nothing can be done. There's been too long of a time. Maybe if Jesus could have healed me back when it was easier, when it was just a fever and a shake, but now that it's full blown, it'll be a little bit harder for him to do something. Let me encourage you that no matter how long you've been waiting for a miracle, no matter how long it seems like that thing has become entrenched in your life, you've had to rearrange your life, rearrange your schedule to work around your handicap or your disability, to work around your sickness and disease, let me encourage you that there is nothing too long that God cannot do something about. If you're not dead yet, Jesus can still work a miracle. And even if you are dead, Jesus can raise you back to life and then heal you from what killed you. But you're not going to die. You're going to live and declare the works of the Lord. Several years ago, I'd gotten the bad news at work that the guy that was supposed to come on shift after me was going to be late. Now, how many know that if somebody picks up your job where you leave off, if they're showing up late, that means you're going to have to stay a little late? And I got the bad news that my coworker was not coming in. Now, they had somebody else to cover, and I said, well, why is he not coming in? They said, because his uncle is in the hospital, and he's gone to see him, and he's been in a medically induced coma since before Thanksgiving. Now, this was February when this story where we pick up. For one reason or another, they had him in a medically induced coma, and they said he has blood clots all through his legs. And how many know that if you have a blood clot in your leg, and just one, if that puppy lets go, you're in deep trouble. But they said he's got blood clots all through his leg. They only give him an 8% chance to live. And I'd been praying, Lord, I want to see your glory. Lord, I want to see you do the supernatural. Lord, I want to see you do the impossible. And here at Walmart, of every ungodly place on the universe, where people come in their pajamas, God says, here's your chance to see the impossible. The Lord put it on my heart to go and pray for that man. So I get off of my shift and I go home to my wife and I say, Jessica, there's a guy in the hospital and I believe that the Lord wants us to go and pray for him. So we're going to go and pray for him. And she says, I'll let you tell the story. She tells all these stories so much better than I do.
It was 11:30 at night and I said, are you kidding me? It's February. It's 7 below 0, and it's in the middle of a storm. I said, well, where's the hospital? I guess we can go 20 minutes. He said, no, it's in Connecticut. I said, Connecticut? I had to work at 6 in the morning. He didn't. So I said, well, you sure you have to go today? He said, I really believe that if we don't go, he'll die. But if we go, he'll be healed. And he said, well, I can go alone. I said, now this is something to admit all this, because when the Lord's moving, you should be on the move with him. I wasn't that night. I was tired. He was already late. And so I said, okay, I'm not going to let you go by yourself. So we hopped in the car and we drove 2.5 hours to this hospital. They brought us in to the room. And what he forgot to tell you is that he had blood clots in his arms too, and they had put these stent things in all of the veins to try to stop them. They said if he lives, which is not, that's why his family's here, because he's probably not going to live through the night. If he lives, he won't be able to walk. He has no muscle tone in his legs or his arms. He probably will be a vegetable because of fevers. We can't really test him right now to see if his brain's going to function or not. But so if he lives, he's going to be in rehab for a year because we'll have to do physical therapy on him and actually move his body for him because he won't be able to do it. And that'll take a really long time. So we went in, and all the people were there, and it was a bad-looking sight. He looked absolutely horrible. And Pastor Joseph said, okay, we're here to pray for him. We asked his wife if we could, and she said yes. We could take all the prayer. We could use every prayer that anyone could say because he's not going to live through the night. And so we just, Pastor Joseph put his hand on one side of his leg, and I was on the other hand, other leg. And what he said to me before we went in is, I know God's going to do something. And at that point, I was mad for almost 2.5 hours. I'll be honest, to get there. But I said, you know what? If this is so moving to him that he feels God is doing this, then I don't want to miss a miracle. And I don't want to be the reason why this doesn't happen, that God doesn't work a miracle, because I have such a bad attitude that I am walking in with doubt instead of faith. And so when we prayed for him, Pastor Joseph said a very simple prayer. He said, Dear God, he said, Jesus, I know, God, I know you hear me always. And if you know the story of Lazarus, that is what Jesus said to his father, is, God, I know you hear me always. He said, I command you, Bob, to live and not die, and declare the works of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. He said, thank you for letting us come and pray. We couldn't put oil on him. They said, don't touch him with anything. Don't touch his skin. We just touched him on the outside of the blanket. We shook everyone's hand, and we walked out. And we got out in the hall, and I said, that's it? He said, that's it. That's what God wanted me to say. And so we have to remember sometimes it's not about what we say. It's about what the Lord is telling us to say. And God isn't into flowery, big, important prayers. He's into the truth of the matter is that he still heals and delivers people today. So we got in the car and drove 2.5 hours home. It was freezing. It felt like the car wasn't even working to keep us warm. We got home. We went to bed. I went to work. And about 4 days later, the wife saw Joseph at Walmart and said, he's been moved to rehab. And he said, what? He's been moved to rehab? Yes. They woke him up out of the coma. They decided he didn't need to be there anymore. So they took him to rehab. So he said, so all the swelling went down in his body? Yes, all the swelling went down in his body. He woke up, so he knows everything. Yeah, he's completely normal. They just said he's got to go to rehab. So he went to rehab. 3 days later, so that's a week. It might have been eight days. In comes Bob in a wheelie cart machine. You know those things they have at Walmart. And he wheeled up to Pastor Joseph and said, hi, I'm Bob. He said, hi, I know. I know you're Bob. He said, I'm here, and I'm in this cart because my wife said I probably shouldn't try to walk, you know, that much this early. So not only did he go to the rehab in 4 days, within 4 days later, he was out and at home and going out into public. And then a week later, Bob was walking through Walmart on his own. He said, my wife makes me take the cane just in case. Everything was normal in his body, in his legs, with his mind. Everything was back to normal within 2 weeks. Now, if you can't see that that's a miracle, that is absolutely amazing that God did that for Bob Weymouth. And I know that there's people here that might have issues and things where they're not, they're sick or they're sick in their body. Bob was healed because of the power of Jesus Christ, not because of anything we did or because we're special, because Jesus said, everyone can work the works that I do, not just me as a pastor's wife and not just Pastor Joseph or your pastors, but every single one of you can walk in the anointing and work the works of Christ. It's about hunger to see God's will be done on the earth. It's about hunger to open up your heart and allow the Lord to use you in the anointing. It's not something to take lightly, the power of the anointing. And I pray that today all of you who need something from the Lord will open up your hearts and allow him to touch you. Because he is a mighty God. He does the same things now that he did for Bob that many years ago.
Yeah, I want you to tell the story of Joni. Now, let me put a background to the story. When your pastor had come and asked me, invited us to come and minister, the Lord said that there would be somebody there that had cancer. And he didn't tell me that in any conversation that I had with him until later, and I asked him, is there somebody there in your church that has cancer? And he said yes. So it's a confirmation to me that if there's cancer in the house today, that when God's power shows up, it's got to leave. Because what God reveals, he heals. What God reveals, he heals. The Lord didn't specifically say anything about anything else except there's somebody there with cancer. So if all we've come for is just one person, that's good enough. But I tell you this story, my wife will tell you this story about a woman named Joni. We had been invited to preach at a church, and there was this woman sitting in the second or third row, and she was hacking and coughing all during my message. And I said, oh, Lord, touch that woman with emphysema. Sometimes we go in our own understanding, our own preconceived ideas, and God just shows us that we're way off base. And I preached a message of God's healing power and invited people to come forward. And she was the first one up. And I said, how can we pray for you? What's going on? And before she could tell me, the Lord gave me a vision and showed me this black area over her intestines. And she said, I have colon rectal cancer, stage 4. The doctors have burned all my insides because of radiation. They've sent me home to die. And I said, do you believe that God can touch you and heal you just like we preached today? She said, yes, I do.
I was worked in a nursing home for a lot of years, 14 years, and I knew what it looked like, what someone who's going to pass very soon, because death has a smell. And I know that's kind of graphic, but it's true. And Joni had the smell on her. And I could see it on her face. She could hardly stand up. They had to walk her up. She was so weak, and she had all this stuff on her mouth and inside her mouth because her hands and fingers and her legs, they had started to turn a little bit gray because when you're passing, your blood doesn't go to your legs and your hands, and it just works on making you stay alive through your heart. And so we went to pray for her, and Pastor Joseph knew what was wrong, you know, and we went to lay our hands on her, and we both prayed, and we felt it go. I felt it go. Pastor Joseph felt it go. The cancer left her body, and we said, wow, it's gone, both at the same time. It's kind of neat, and so we were looking at her, and brightness came back into her eyes immediately. She wiped her mouth, and that was the last bit of white stuff that we saw on her face. She stopped coughing right then she stopped coughing. And she stood up. And there was a man in the back, an older man in the back, and he said, I have to say something. I don't usually say things. I'm shy, but I need to say something right now. He said, I'm not like this, but I feel I need to tell everyone. that when you prayed for her and when you said, cancer, come out in Jesus' name, I saw it come out and go up in the air, and it looked like a shriveled up, kind of like a baby, a mass of stuff, like a baby that was rotten and shriveled up. And then when you said come out, it came out and it just got sucked out into an open heaven. And that's when you said, it's gone. And we knew it was gone, but that was a picture to the other people of a man who doesn't normally say anything to be able to see that and know. But we went on to pray for some other people, and Joni, she stood there. She walked herself back to her seat. And she didn't cough. She had nothing wrong with her face. The grayness left her face, so she had color. And at the end, we had a table where we were selling some things. She walked down the stairs all by herself onto the table, and she said, you know, I know I'm totally healed. I said, I know you are too, Joni. She said, no, I really know I'm totally healed. And she said, I know that I'm so healed. They told me I was going to die within the next week and a half, and that I needed to have all my family come and spend a week with me. She said, but when I came in here, I wasn't sure that I was going to live through the day. But now I know that I'm going to live. I'm going to buy this picture here that says, as for me and my house, I'll serve the Lord. And she said, I'm going to put that on my nightstand because the Lord has declared that I'm going to live and not die. And we went back there a year later, and Joni was totally back to her normal weight. She was a nurse. She had gone back to nursing 3 days a week because she was already 72. So she was already older. But so she went back to nursing 3 days a week. When she talked with us, she said that they had burned everything in my insides. I didn't have anything left that worked. I had a colostomy bag. Well, I've just had an appointment for them to reverse that. And my insides are totally fine, so that they think that I could make it and reverse this operation so that I can live a normal life. Joni went on to live 9 more years. And what an amazing thing. She only had a week, and the Lord gave her 9 more years on the earth to declare his goodness to the people, not just in that church, but to her family. And I know that if God healed Joni and if God healed Bob, and the times that God has healed me, that he'll heal everyone. That he's not someone who just picks a certain person because he likes them better. That's not how God works. God works on faith. He doesn't work on need. And that's where a lot of us get confused, is that we think that because we need something so much that God will answer. That's not how God works. There's a lot of needs in the world. There's a lot of needs in the world. The needs are to be met by people. We are the hands and feet of the Lord to meet the needs of people. God works on faith. Jesus works on the faith of the people, not the need. There's a lot of needs. And faith is what brings him to heal you and to deliver whatever problem you have. So if you have faith and you know that God can do it, it's not about thinking God can do it and, oh, well, I know God will do it sometime. No, faith is, I know God can, I know he will, and he will right now. Talking faith is talking about faith in a future way. Even though you can't see it, you move in faith. I haven't always been able to see the things that God has for me or healing when it's happening, but I have faith to know that if I move into that, God will deliver those things to me. Sometimes we think, no, I want to get healed by next time December. No, God doesn't. No, that's not how it works. I want to be healed now because I'm hungry for the presence and the anointing of God. I'm hungry now for God to move. Not, well, I hope by June I'll be able to go on that vacation and the Lord will help my leg so that I can do it. No, God wants to heal your leg today. He doesn't want you to have to go till June with a limp. He wants you to be healed now and today. And it's up to us to have the faith and move out in the faith, into a moving faith, because faith is not just a word, it's an action. Faith is all of our hearts and all of our being, our very spirit pulling on the power of God. That's what faith is. I'm going to pull on the power of God and allow him to move in my life.
Lazarus had a great need. Jesus took his time in getting there. But his glory wasn't displayed until Jesus had said to the sisters, "Didn't I tell you that if you would believe, you would see my glory?" Not because of your great need, because like Pastor Jessica said, there's a lot of great needs out there. But he said, if you want to see the glory of God, you've got to believe. Can I tell you one more quick story? I promise it'll be quick. Joni had a friend that he personally identified with her story, and he was just, you know, a friend of hers and just so compassionate to her. And he was not there during the service that one year, but the following year when we came, he showed up and he said, "You know, I was kicking myself in the rear end. I missed Joni's miracle. I love Joni so much, and the Lord had great compassion through me upon her, and I missed her miracle because I had that four-letter word, work, that Sunday. But he said, I'm here today, and I know if God healed Joni, that he can heal me. And I said, well, what can we pray for you about, brother? And he said, well, 19 years ago, I was in a skiing accident, and I broke my shoulder. And he said, it's been, I delayed in having surgery on it, and the shoulder and the bone, it fused together. And he said, I can't move it very well. And I said, well, show me what you couldn't do. And he said, well, I was like, I'm a man, so I'm a little tense sometimes. Let's be honest. And that's why it's great that my wife is always with me. She helps to explain things to me. And she said, well, you notice that he is showing you what he can't do. He can't reach his arm behind his head. He said, yeah, I haven't been able to comb the back of my head for 19 years. 19 years. Maybe you think Jesus has delayed himself in coming to you, or maybe you think your situation, a problem, you've just been able to live with it and get on life on with it. But this man, 19 years, I said, will you believe that the Lord will heal you just like we preached? And he said, yes, I do. I said, well, and you know, I have to say, the Lord doesn't always reveal things to us by the Spirit of what needs prayer, but the gift of faith kicks in, and sometimes the Lord shows me specific things to do. Like there was one man in our church, he came forward for prayer because he had gout in his feet. And as I was standing in front of him, I had a vision of what the Lord wanted me to do, and I said, Lord, ain't no way. I said, Lord, ain't no way. And he just kept showing me, and I knew that if I wasn't obedient, he'd walk away the same as when he walked in, but if I would be obedient, that the Lord would do something in his life. And so I think I was wearing these shoes, anointed shoes of the Lord, and in the vision, I saw myself stomp on his feet. So I stomped on his feet. And how many know sometimes the Lord will have you do some unusual things? I mean, standing at the Red Sea, God says, what do you have in your hand, Moses? Raise that puppy up and see the deliverance of God. Who's the nutcase standing on the rock with a rod? He's the one seeing a miracle. So this nutcase stomped on this guy's foot. Then he went back to his seat. We got on with service, and next week rolls around, and he comes back, and he said, I just want to say last week was a little odd. I said, I'm glad I wasn't the only one thinking that. But he said, the day before, I'd gone into the walk-in clinic because the gout was so bad in my feet, excruciating pain, and I had come to church in excruciating pain. But as soon as the pastor stomped on my feet, all the pain left, and I've had no problem since. So the Lord showed us something to do with this man in his shoulder, and I just grabbed his arm and cranked it up, and it came loose. Now, psychosomatic, that might be one thing. Well-wishing somebody, you know, oh, we're going to try to drum up some faith to get this cancer taken care of. Oh, God, please show up. That's another thing. But if God bestows upon you the gift of faith and he shows you what to do, whether it's stomping on somebody's foot or doing some other physical act like breaking loaves and fishes, we've got to be obedient to what God shows us to do. And let's pray that the Lord doesn't show me to drop kick anybody today. I'm hoping, and you are too. But the man, his shoulder came free, and he was doing this. Woo! 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 Because I said, do something that you couldn't do before. And he was doing it. You know, just like Jesus told the lame man, rise up and walk. He told him to do something by faith, something that he couldn't do before. Because how many know lame people can't walk? But Jesus gave the command of faith, rise up and walk. Didn't say Jesus did anything else, but that man rose up and he walked. To the man with the withered hand, the last thing that that man could do was to stretch out his hand. But at the command of faith, worked a miracle, and he reached forth his hand. I said, do something you couldn't do before. Let's test this out that God has done. And he was hooting like an owl on adrenaline. Woo! Woo! And he was moving it all around, free 100%. He said, this is great. This is wonderful. And I said, well, praise the Lord. We're going to pray for other people. Go back to your seat. And he went back to his seat all excited. And after service, his wife met my wife. And she said, oh, it's a wonderful thing that the Lord has done in my husband. Jessica said, oh, I know. So wonderful. The Lord touched his shoulder and, you know, he was hooting a little bit there. And, you know. She said, no, you don't understand. And I appreciate what Pastor said this morning, that no matter what you have need of, whether it's physical or emotional or mental, God is able to heal you, deliver you, set you free. And she said, no, you don't understand. She said, yeah, that's great. That frozen shoulder for 19 years, God's healed him. But he's this type of man that has no expression of emotion whatsoever. Not only was he physically disabled because of his shoulder, but he was emotionally disabled in his soul, where he could not express or feel emotion. She said, I have to ask him, are you having a good day? Are you having a bad day? Do you feel happy? Do you feel sad? What's going on? And he would say, I don't know. I'm okay. She said, so for him to do this hooting, whoo, 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 is like any one of us normal people running around the church screaming at the top of their lungs, hallelujah. She said, so not only did God heal him and give him a great miracle in his shoulder, but God has done something in his soul. How many know that in the presence of God, in the glory of God, God not only works on your inside, but he works on your outside. And not only does he work on your outside, but he works on your inside to restore and deliver and to make whole, to make clean. I close with this. God took Moses to the cleft of the rock, and he said, I've got to hide you in this rock in order for you to see my glory, in order to see my presence to pass before you. There was a passing by experience of God's presence and God's glory. And then Jesus came. And the ultimate goal of Jesus was not just to download another system of worship, to download another ethical, moral standard of living. But his destiny was to go to the cross. He said, "Not my will, but thy will be done." It was a hard thing. Love poured out on that cross. Just as God, Moses had seen the glory of God in the cleft of the rock, Jesus said to Peter, "Upon this rock I shall build my church." And he wasn't talking about Peter. He was talking about what he was going to do as the Messiah. If you ever want to experience the power and the presence of God in your life, if you need sins forgiven, the only place you will find it is in the cleft of the rock of the cross of Calvary. There is always a tie to God's glory, his blood, and being hidden in the cleft of the rock. Not just that, but Colossians 3:3 says that when we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, that we are now hid in Christ in God. We are hid like Moses in the cleft of the rock. We are hid in Christ, and everything that heaven has to offer is to be enjoyed in the exclusivity of that cave. Salvation is the entrance of the cave into the goodness of God. Salvation is just the starting point. You've got nowhere with God until you start with the cross. But once you allow that cross to wash over your soul, you enter into the cave of his glory and his goodness. Will you bow your heads today? I want to invite you this morning, if you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, if you have never allowed the goodness of God to come to you through Jesus, and you want to receive him today, I'm not going to embarrass you, I'm not going to have you come forward, but where you are right now, I want you to just lift up your hand. You want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. First time decision today. Raise your hand. Maybe you've had a relationship with the Lord and you've grown cold and you want to come back to the Lord. I want to encourage you to raise your hand now in this holy moment to rededicate your life to the Lord. If that is you, raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Father, we come before you today. We have to admit that we are in need of a fresh cleansing of your blood. We want to receive everything that you have for us, and we cannot receive it except through the blood of Jesus Christ. So, Father, where we have walked with you before, where we've left off, we want to pick up again. Will you say this prayer with me, everyone, all together, out loud? Dear Jesus, thank you for going to the cross. Thank you that your love is everlasting. There is no sin too great or too small that you cannot forgive or does not need forgiveness. I declare that you are my Lord, you are my Savior, and your blood cleanses me now. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.